So thank you for the study, experience of Tsongkapa. And the last class, we talked about the motivation for how you're going to attend the Lamrim teaching. Then second, we talk about you must do analysis and research about the teaching, which is you're going to receive or which is you're going to practice. So there are three motivations. Very ordinary motivation was is a motivation for only overcome from the lower realm. In order to overcome the lower realm, you need to avoid the non-virtuous karma. You need to practice the only virtues. And you really need to know what is the cause and condition for the lower realm. How I can overcome from the lower realm. The second motivation is motivation for nirvana, only for yourself. You don't need to think about it, you don't need to worry about other sentient beings, you just only worry about yourself. I really want to achieve nirvana in order to benefit only for me. So this is second motivation. The third one, the motivation for buddhahood, or omniscient, also motivation for omniscient. That means, as a Mahayana practitioner, you really need to develop the last one, the motivation for omniscient or motivation for buddhahood, in order to benefit all sentient beings. So, any kinds of practice, usually you do, first you need to cultivate the motivation, which is benefit for all sentient beings. So last time we talked a little bit about the motivation, suddenly we stuck somewhere. The page number, I talked a little bit, page number 18, the last paragraph. In general, it is vital to have one of these three motivations at the beginning of any practice. Generally, it's so important you must have three. Especially when you listen to discourse on the Lamrim, just any motivation is not sufficient. So that's why when you listen to discourse on the Lamrim teaching, when you practice Lamrim, when you practice, any kind of Mahayana teaching, you must, develop the bodhicitta. The first, second is not sufficient, not enough. Then he said, you must at least listen in conjunction with force or contrast from a bodhicitta. So conjunction, conjunction is very important words. So, while you listening to Lamrim, that moment the motivation was not there in visible level. In the deep level, the motivation was always there, must be always there. So, same, before you listening to Lamrim teaching, you cultivate, you develop the bodhicitta. So there are, two levels of bodhicitta. I'm not saying two types of two levels. One is force or contrived form of bodhicitta. I think we have to put together. Contrived or force form of bodhicitta. It means, it's not really genuine. So before you listening Lamrim teaching, before you practice Lamrim, before you, offering candlelight, before you do some recitation, you just cultivate the bodhicitta. generally you don't have, you know, you don't have the bodhicitta, but you have to develop at that moment. Then you go force or control from bodhicitta. Then within the motivation, then you can start any kind of practice. First you develop bodhicitta, you know, that means I must, you know, do this kind of practice in order to benefit, no, I must do the practice in order to achieve buddhahood for benefit all sentient beings. This is the motivation. Within that motivation, then you can sit up practice, you can sit up meditation, you can sit up recitation without losing the sense of, you know, bodhicitta. So usually we take example. For example, when we lost very dear one, you know, your dear brother or sister or husband or parents, when you lost someone, and when you eating a food, when you drink a something, water, tea, at that moment you are eating food or you are drinking a water, but in the deep down, you always remember the dear one, right? Who passed away, or you lost something. In the deep down, you remember. But then when you, even though when you're eating something, even though when you talk with your friend, but you still in the deep down, you remember, oh, I lost my dear one, right? So that moment you have a true kinds of, you know, sensation, two kinds of, two types of mind. One mind is very aware, very visible. So you are talking with someone, you are tasting food, you are drinking water. And the other mind is remember the dear one which you lost. So that moment you have a two kinds of minds there. It's same, you know, first you must develop bodhicitta, then without losing the force, without losing the sense of bodhicitta, then you start practice. Whatever you practice, without losing the, you know, sense of bodhicitta continuously. On the other hand, before you practice bodhicitta, or before you practice compassion, before you do some kind of prostration, offering mandala, you know, recitation, or you can develop kind of understanding of emptiness. Try to understand the nature of all phenomena. Try to understand the things which are around you is impermanence. Then you understand, yeah, things are impermanent. Then you have a mind which understand things are impermanent. But without losing the sense of impermanence, then you can start practice anything. That means, you know, conjoin. It's be, but Tibetan we use directly the whole, you know, just the one mind hold other mind. That means the bodhicitta mind hold the understanding of emptiness. The bodhicitta mind hold any kind of practice. That means the mind is always there. It look like, I give you an example, you know, while you eating something, but even though that moment you remember that which you lost. For example, if you lost big money, if you lost some very valuable object, right? Why are you talking with someone? As you are really talking with someone, but in the deep down you always remember, oh, I lost my money, I lost my car, I lost my job. There's a two minds. There's a, you know, conjunction is very important. Then, you know, so if you have this kind of two minds, one mind which say, you know, mind towards buddhahood, or mind towards understanding emptiness, then your practice have a true kinds of practice of methods and practice of wisdom. That you are kind of joining true practice, wisdom and, you know, bodhicitta, wisdom and compassion. According to Mahayana, you know, teaching, all practice, any kinds of practice must include into practice of bodhicitta or practice of wisdom. There's no more any kind of practice which is not included into methods or wisdom. All compassion, kindness, tolerance, faith, you know, belief in Buddha, Dharma, Sangha, all of you include, methods. Then, meditation on emptiness, meditate on impermanence, meditate on the Four Noble Truths. They are included in wisdom. We have two practice, methods and wisdom. Sometimes you can develop methods without losing the methods, and you can enter into wisdom of practice. Sometimes you can develop the wisdom first, then you can enter in the methods. There is a hold the mind each other. It's so important. Conjoin. Then we finish the motivation. Now you know what kind of motivation you must need when you practice, when you enter, when you do actual practice. Second, now you feel, yes, I know, I can understand if I reborn in the lower realm, suffering. Even though if I born in, in a higher realm, I will have suffering. There's not any place, in the samsara, I will be, totally happy. Then you feel, yes, I must overcome the samsara. The second question, I should overcome myself, or I should consider all sentient beings? Then you must say, yes, I must consider all sentient beings, because all sentient beings are, have a connection with me. If I just think only myself, is not good. Then you think, in order to benefit, beneficial for all sentient beings, how I can? There are hundreds of thousands of millions of sentient beings. We are not only talking human beings. Yes, I can give a food to sentient beings who are hungry. I can give a clothes to people who need clothes, medicine, shelter, whatever. But there are very minor, very small benefit for them. The best one you should think, yes, in order to have a real beneficial, I must teach them how to overcome from samsara, how to achieve liberation, how to achieve nirvana, how to achieve buddhahood. This is the best benefit for them. So in order to give a teaching, I must need omniscience. Because there are so many sentient beings. So when you stay with a dog, you really want to give something. But you can give a food, cloth, but you really wish to teach Dharma for your dog, for your cat, for your, like a bird. How? You don't know what kind of, mental disposition they have. You don't know what kind of teaching will be benefit to them. Then you must know their mental disposition. So in order to know the mental disposition very detailedly, then you need omniscience. So in order to achieve omniscience, you need to practice Dharma. In order to practice Dharma, you need to find the right Dharma. Right? So the right Dharma is is taught by Buddha Shakyamuni, is approved by Pandita. Or we must say, oh, this is the right teaching, because this person, that person gain, kind of insight of realization. So why it is so important to do study, ask question, do investigation about teaching? Because now you are looking very kind of big, you are doing kind of very important job. Because look at, I really want to achieve Buddhahood. In order to achieve Buddhahood, I must practice Dharma. If you meet the wrong Dharma, you're going to have a big loss. That's why also your good future, your bad future also depend on Dharma. So that's why it's so important to study Dharma. then how we can, how I can understand, how I can know this dharma is right, that dharma is wrong. Then they say, you know, that the dharma must taught by Buddha Shakyamuni, approved by Pandita. We must need someone who, you know, gain realization through practice this certain teaching. So we, you know, then we finish the, you know, about motivation. Then we talk about a little bit how, why it is so important to do research about the dharma. And he said, even a simple thing, very simple, you know, object, when we buy, we ask a lot of questions. And finally, when we convinced that this object, that thing is really good, then we finally buy, then we use it, right? Then he said, look at with very ordinary things, we have a lot of questions. We must do a lot of questions about dharma. Then the last one, I think we stop. Okay, the page number 21. Now, what we call the Lamrim was not invented by Jirbuche. Generally, when you when somebody says Lamrim, most people think, yes, Lamrim is the Gelugpa teaching. It's not, you know, the Lamrim is not invented by Jirbuche or Atisha. You know, his lineage stems from the completely perfect Buddha himself and from him alone. So the Lamrim is not invented by Tsongkapa, not invented by Atisha. It is come from Buddha. It's not taught by Buddha Shakyamuni. But when you come to understand the teaching beyond whether they have been given the name Lamrim, you know, even though when you look at Heart Sutra, we don't use the name of Lamrim, which is Heart Sutra. You know, we have a certain name. But if you understand the meaning of Lamrim, that means Heart Sutra also Lamrim. And also look at, we have a Kagyupa tradition. Look at the Kagyu. Ka is the teaching of Buddha. You know, Buddha words or Buddha teaching. According to their tradition, not any single word which is not, you know, benefit for achieving enlightenment. All words, any kinds of, it must show you, it must lead you to the omniscient or to the nirvana. It's not directly, you know, single word is not directly saying nirvana, omniscient, but slowly and gradually the words is leading towards nirvana or omniscient. So, you know, we have, according to Tibetan Buddhism, we have a Nyingma tradition, we have a Kagyu, then we have a Sakya, then we have a Gelugpa tradition. They are different tradition, but the teaching are same. Also, we have a Chinese Buddhism, we have a Thai Buddhism, we have a Sri Lanka. Look at the tradition, the culture are different, the language are different. If you look at the actual teaching, you know, Four Noble Truths is the foundation. The 12 links interdependence. Then, you know, add an unfold Arya paths. All, you know, the Buddhist tradition talking about Four Noble Truths. You know, 12 links interdependence. You know, mindfulness, Buddhahood, Nirvana, omniscience. That's mean, you know, all teaching is leading towards omniscience or Nirvana. But at the moment they're talking certain thing, but actually it leads to, you know, omniscience. For example, you know, when you meet a doctor, you got some headache. And doctor say, oh, you must drink certain juice. You must eat certain food. But the food is not directly, you know, recovering the headache, but is benefit indirectly to overcome the headache. Then the doctor will give you a medicine. You know, he gives some certain, you know, advice, shouldn't eat this food, you must eat this food and take the medicine. also eat food, also, you know, find gradually its benefit for the, you know, overcome the headache. So, you know, we all Buddha words, Buddha teaching are Lamrim. When you come to enter the teaching, beyond whether they have been given the name Lamrim, while other have not, you will see that all the scripture are the Lamrim. The precious, you know, special set of the perfection of wisdom, Sudara, is the superior, you know, outstanding Lamrim, that most excellent among all the teaching of our teacher. In their Sudara, he taught directly the profound stage of the path, which is the, you know, profound atom of the 84,000 bundles of Dharma. He also covertly taught the extensive part of the Lamrim in. There's been, when you look at, you know, the Parajabrahmada teaching, it has a two meaning. One, usually we can say, you know, the visible meaning. And then other, we say the hidden meaning. Generally, direct meaning, indirect meaning, and hidden meaning. The indirect meaning, you must understand through understand the direct meaning. When you understand the direct meaning, then you can understand the indirect meaning too. Indirect meaning and the hidden meaning is not same, exactly same. For example, you know, direct, indirect means, for example, you are looking a cup. You are looking this particular this cup. You are looking a cup. You say, where's the my pen? The word saying pen, but actually you are saying cup, right? Because in your mind you are looking a cup. You're supposed to say a cup, but you says pen. The pen is not the direct meaning. It's the, you know, you see, it is the literal meaning. The direct meaning is a cup. Then indirect meaning, after you understand the direct meaning, then there is another meaning which is not told directly. Direct and indirect. The hidden meaning you don't understand by through the, you know, logic, through reasoning, through your own study. You must rely on certain, you know, masters or certain guru, the hidden one. For example, in the Heart Sutra, there's, you know, in the Heart Sutra says, no eyes. The direct meaning is the emptiness of the eyes. The indirect meaning is the eyes. Hidden meaning is the, you know, the path which is understand the emptiness of the eyes. That's why we have a, you know, the profound teaching, which is the emptiness. Then we have an extensive meaning, which is all the paths. The, you know, great compassion, bodhicitta, 12 links independent. There are, we call, hidden meaning of the Parajabrahmada teaching. Same Heart Sutra has a, you know, three meanings: direct, indirect, hidden. All the extensive path is hide and then the meaning of emptiness. Now we have a two lineage of, you know, Buddha teaching, lineage of the profound teaching and lineage of the extensive teaching. Okay, so in profound atom of the 84,000 bundles of the Dharma, he also convertly taught the extensive part of the Lamrim in them. Also intensive parts of Lamrim, also included the methods of the Buddhas. This then is the source of the lineage. The extensive part was passed on to the Buddha's former disciple Maitreya. So, you know, after Buddha passed away, the Mitra Buddha, he carried the profound, you know, lineage of the teaching. So Buddha passed on to Mitra Buddha, who in turn passed it on to the Asanga, the profound one. The extensive one, then, you know, source of lineage, extensive path was passed on to the Buddha's formal disciple Mitra, who in turn passed in on the Asanga. Buddha, you know, passed to the Mitra, then Mitra passed on to the Asanga. The profound part of the Lamrim passed from Manjushri to Nagarjuna. Buddha passed to the Manjushri, Manjushri to Nagarjuna. This is how the Lamrim lineage split into two, the profound and the extensive. So you know, the Nagarjuna is the one of the very important master. He composed the six, you know, in order to clarify the Lamrim, Mitra composed, you know, wrote his five treatises. Asanga wrote the five texts on the level. The Nagarjuna has six, you know, logic treatises. So Mitra composed the five treatises. So, you know, according to Tibetan monastic tradition, so we have to memorize all the five texts. This, you know, Asanga, five texts on the level, also we have to memorize them. And Nagarjuna has a six logic treatises, is most talking about the emptiness and so on. So the profound and extensive Lamrim lineage come down separately to the great priestess Adisha. Until Adisha, the two lineage carry separately. You know, the one master, you know, they don't receive all together until Adisha. You know, so he received the extensive lineage from Sravana Deva, you know. So Adisha received the true lineage. So he received the extensive lineage from Sravana Deva, and the profound from the, you know, Vidya Kulia, Kokali. He compound the two into one stream. I think Suvarna Devapa is from, Malaysia, right?
Indonesia.
So I hope you know the story, you know. And when he was young, Adisha, he was really looking, you know, the best kind of practice, which is he can achieve Buddhahood, omniscient. Then he understood, you know, yes, the Lamrim, particularly the bodhicitta, is the best way I can achieve enlightenment, I can achieve omniscience. Then he was looking the, you know, instruction of lineage of the bodhicitta. Then he noticed, yes, there was a very famous master in Indonesia, right? Then he went to Indonesia. It took, I think, 12 months to reach to Indonesia from India, from Bangalore. Then finally, he spent, I think, 8 years in Indonesia with the master, and he received all the lineage, all the teaching from the master, you know, Sravana Deva. He also inherited the lineage or did, you know, bestowing great blessing the Shanti Deva received from Manju Gokha, as well as the lineage of the secret tantra and so on. So look at the true lineage and received to Adisha, and he combined two lineage. And when he went to Tibet, the first time he wrote, you know, the state of meditation, right? The teaching name, Lamrim. I think we can learn later. Tantra. Adisha composed his Lamrim here on the path to enlightenment in Tibet. So this was, you know, this was, it is the first time
you know, the name used, the Lamrim name used, you know, it's composed, this name used by Adisha in Tibet. This work, you know, accompanies the key tone of the complete doctrine. Since that time, the you know, conviction of the calling, the teaching by name Lamrim developed. After that, the lineage, you know, concerning right, performed view and extensive. Now we have two lineage, all the two lineage received to the Adisha, then Adisha composed the Lamrim, then they spread in Tibet. So after that, you know, there's a lot of kind of history of Lamrim. After that, you know, one day Tsongkapa was in somewhere, he was doing a lot of prayer to the Adisha. Finally, he got a lot of vision, you know, Adisha, so other master. Finally, Adisha said, okay, you must, you know, do a lot of things for the Dharma, I can help you. That's when that moment Adisha request or said to Tsongkapa, you must compose, you know, you must write a Lamrim. Then Tsongkapa wrote the great Lamrim. He almost finished. Then he stopped somewhere. And somehow then Majushiru also said to Tsongkapa, you must complete the great Lamrim. So, you know, generally the Lamrim is not just, you know, invented by Tsongkhapa, no, nothing Gelugpa tradition. It's in all Buddha teaching are Lamrim. So there's a two types of, you know, lineage, profound and extensive. Through practice of profound Lamrim, you know, it can reduce the negative emotion. Finally, it can cut the root of the samsara. Through practice of extensive lineage, you can develop first renunciation, then bodhicitta, you know, then you know the first five parts, so and so. That's mean the true lineage is very important. As a practitioner, as a Buddhism, you know, Buddhist, we must practice both of them, the profound teaching and the extensive teaching. Extensive is nothing, you know, really huge thing. This means you know, the most of the method side. Next, we can just start from the day two, Lamrim. Day two, you know, Great Tsongkhapa, in his introduction to the three fundamental of the path, there's a particular text which is written by Tsongkhapa. He mentioned about the three fundamental paths. I shall explain as best I can the importance of the essence of all the victors scriptures. The path, you know, praised by the holy victors and their children. The gateway of the fortunate wanting liberation. The importance of the essence of all the victors scriptures. That's the Lamrim, you know, Lamrim include all the essence of the Bodhisattva practice. Also, you know, the Lamrim put all the essence of the Mahayana teaching. Right? The importance of the essence of all the victor scriptures. What does mean here? Victors. Victor. The synonym, victor and bodhisattva is the synonym, okay? Here generally. Generally, not, you know, all victor is bodhisattva. Here, victor and bodhisattva is synonym. Then the path, you know, praised by the holy victor and the children. And the path which is mentioned in Lamrim, okay, the path which is mentioned in Lamrim, it is praised by the holy victor, their children. In the Lamrim or in the mini Buddha teaching, you can see, you know, sometimes the son of the Buddha. Sometimes you can see the victor and their children. So when you have the victor and their children, then there's a true level, kind of, you know, a bodhisattva. One who just reached to the second path, first and second, accumulation path, and, you know, Mahayana, you know, accumulation path and preparation path. Who reach the true level of path, we can call child or children of victor. And the next one, who reach not only first, second, third, or fourth, then we call the victor, in a great victor. You know, there's a five paths. The first, who receive the first path, first, second, we can call child or victor. Who reach to the, you know, next two of them, then we can call, you know, again victor. The gateway of the fortunate wanting liberation. So this is very important, the gateway for the fortunate wanting liberation. So here fortunate, why they use, he used the Tsongkhapa use fortunate, why he used the gateway, then why he used the wanting liberation. Look at fortunate. So the disciple at the Buddha time who received the Mahayana teaching, who practiced the Mahayana teaching, they were very fortunate. And in the Tsongkhapa moment, Tsongkhapa lifetime, the person who practiced, who listened, you know, who preserved the Mahayana teaching, they are very fortunate. So now we also very consider, yes, I'm very fortunate to, you know, to have this kind of opportunity to study Lamrim, listening Lamrim, practice Lamrim. Very fortunate. Why fortunate? Because if you seriously follow the Lamrim, so this is your, you know, the kind of turning point. You go in, you know, the Nirvana, or you go in the lower part, or, you know, or realm, or you go in the samsara, or you just, you know, escape the samsara. Is your turning point. You seriously follow the Lamrim, you will able to escape samsara. This was very fortunate. Then the gateway, you know. So the bodhicitta is the essence of all in the Buddhist, you know, Mahayana teaching. And the bodhicitta is the place by holy victorious. The bodhicitta is the gateway. Gateway is kind of door, okay? So I told you before, three refuged, Buddha, Dharma, Sangha is the gateway of Buddhist. If you know, really believe in three jewels, you are in, you know, Buddhist. If you don't accept, if you don't believe, you are out of the Buddhist, is the gateway. Gateway of Buddhist and non-Buddhist. Then there is another gateway of Bodhisattva and non-Bodhisattva. The bodhicitta is the gateway. If you, you know, generally able to develop, then you have a bodhicitta within your still mind. Then you are bodhicitta, Bodhisattva. You are in Bodhisattva. If you are not able to develop bodhicitta, then you are not in of the Bodhisattva, you are of the Bodhisattva, it's a gateway. Okay, also there's a gateway of Buddhist and non-Buddhist, there's a gateway of Bodhisattva and non-Bodhisattva, there's a gateway of, you know, enter in the path or non-enter in the path, the renunciation. If you generally able to develop genuine renunciation, then you are enter into the path. So in order to, you know, enter in the real path, you don't have to develop bodhicitta. Because there's a three types of path, right? One is the real path, realization, realization path and bodhisattva path. The renunciation is the gateway of entering the path, gateway. So, Tsongkhapa said, you know, I shall explain as best I can. What? He going to explain about bodhicitta. Because bodhicitta is, you know, essence of all the Victor scripture, all the Mahayana scripture. I shall explain as best I can the bodhicitta, because bodhicitta is the place by Holy Victor and the children, Holy Victor or the Buddha, and the gateway of originate wanting liberation. Look at, so we cannot achieve liberation just simply by doing some, you know, recitation, some simple practice. So you have to practice, you know, the bodhicitta. Here's the liberation is not talking about, you know, the ordinary liberation. It's talking about liberate from all defiled mind, defilement, liberation of, you know, all the all the ignorance. This teaching is the, you know, contents of all the scripture of victors. So the Lamrim, you know, contents all of them. When you study the Lamrim thoroughly, that's when you look like studying all Buddha teaching, because it consists, you know, contain all Buddha teaching as well as the, you know, the victor teaching. In the small scope section, you become moved to the renounce the lower realm. And in the medium scope, you are moved to the renounce all samsara. If you are able to develop, you know, the small scope section or small scope path, then you move to the renounce. Renounce where? Renounce the lower realm. Then next, you know, in the medium scope, if you are able to develop the path of medium scope, then you are moved to the renounce of samsara, the renunciation also. But you will not achieve this unless you depend on the Lamrim, precious bodhicitta Lamrim. So without rely on Lamrim, you cannot develop, you know, you cannot have the small scope paths, medium scope paths, as well as, you know, the precious bodhicitta. The precious bodhicitta is the path passed by the holy victors, ones and their children. The gateway for people who want liberation. You know, in order to achieve liberation, you need to know the correct view, emptiness. In order to achieve, you know, the liberation, this moment liberation, you know, because liberation is preferred to say the Buddhahood, the free of the extent. Okay, here, you know, the correct view. The correct view, when you understand the correct view, you have to, you avoid the two extreme. What are the two extreme? You know, substantialism, right? Substantialism and nihilism. And this beginner is a bit difficult to understand. One reason, according to Theravada tradition, they said, you know, the Mahayana teaching is not, didn't teach by Buddha Shakyamuni. It is not Buddha teaching. Because in the Mahayana teaching, they're talking about emptiness. According to their understanding, empty is like a nothingness. According to Theravada tradition, you know, Thai, Sri Lanka, or Bali, they say Mahayana teaching is not the teaching of Buddhas, because they're talking about emptiness. They're talking empty is empty. This is wrong. Then because they don't understand the meaning of emptiness. If you just, you know, literally, there's a no eyes. If you think there's no eyes, then you are all in the nihilism, nothingness. For example, you know, when we have the tennis class, we talk about the true extreme, extreme of nihilism, extreme of, you know, substantialism. And Tibetan words will be very easy. We say, you know, permanent extreme and nothingness and extreme. So when you look at a particular object, generally for we thought everything is correct, everything is right. For example, this is glasses, right? Glass, glasses, right? Sis. Just simply, you can see here, this is glasses. In my hand, there's a glasses. If you look at the glasses very carefully, you know, very precisely, where's the glasses? Yes, in your hand, right? So which one is really glasses? This is, you know, this kind of handle, right? We can say handle. This is the kind of frame. And this is part of the glasses. If you look each part of this, you cannot find glasses. Then you thought, oh, maybe, you know, a glasses not exist. Nothing not exist. Because I cannot find from the object side. That means you are looking, you are falling in the nihilism, nothingness. Then you thought, oh, it is not true, because of course the glass is there, the house is there, my friends are there. It's not true, they must be there. Then you think, okay, my friend or my house is exists from the object side. This exists, you know, solidly. Also, you are falling into one of the, you know, extreme of, you know, substantialism. So, once you understand emptiness, it looks like everything is, look like dream. Why you have a dream? You know, you have a, you know, beautiful dream. That moment you have a really sense of feeling, sense of happiness, sense of attachment, sense of desire. Because that moment you are seeing very beautiful object, beautiful things. When you have very scary dream, you feel scared. You know, you are not happy. After you awake from, you know, awake sleep. You think about the dream. You shouldn't say the dream wasn't exist, right? The dream was there. What was look like? It is just, you know, kind of there, but not exist solidly. Things are like that. Think about the people which you met yesterday. Think about the food which you ate yesterday and today, all the things which is you have experienced in the past, it look like dream, right? You shouldn't say, I didn't meet someone. Yeah, you met someone yesterday, but today they look like, totally look like dream. So, you know, emptiness is, you know, things are there, everything exists. You know, I exist, you exist, the house exists, you know, everything exists. They exist in different ways. What we perceive, you know, when we look at the object, we can think the object exists solidly, inherently, you know, independently. In the reality, nothing exists solidly, independently. Things exist dependently, not independently. Then finally you study any kind of object, then you can understand, yes, things are there, but it exists in different way. Finally you can understand, yes, I have very strong, you know, ignorance about the reality. So in order to understand the right view or the correct view, you have to avoid true extreme. Okay, extreme of nihilism, extreme of, you know, substantialism. You're not able to
avoid the nihilism, then finally you think we are nothing exists. There's no Buddha, no Dharma, no next life, no previous life, nothing. Then finally you think nobody exists around me. Then how you can exist? You know. So you have to avoid two extremes in order to understand the emptiness. So that's why we call that emptiness is the profound meaning. It's profound, so difficult to understand. But according to Tibetan tradition, Buddhist tradition, we can say understanding of emptiness is so difficult. Understanding, have the right concept, but very easy to understand. When you hear, it's so difficult to understand the meaning. If you try to understand, it's quite easy to understand. The bodhicitta is so easy to understand, right? Great compassion, so easy to understand. If you try to cultivate, if you try to practice, not easy. So it's opposite, and just emptiness of, the concept of emptiness is so difficult to understand. It is so difficult to understand the meaning, but you can understand very easily. Bodhicitta, the concept of bodhicitta is so very easy to understand, but so difficult to cultivate, so difficult to develop. So, that's why we performed a true extent, right? Yet you will not achieve this unless you depend on the Lamrim, system of teaching. Therefore, in order to gain Buddhahood, you must develop the three fundamental of path in your mind stream. Three fundamental: the renunciation, bodhicitta, understanding of emptiness. You must depend on the Lamrim to generate these three in your mind stream. So, without practicing three of them, then there's no way you can achieve liberation, you can achieve omniscience of Buddhahood. So, as I mentioned before, you look at the initiation. Long term initiation, Kalachaka initiation, Yamendaka, because you got so many sessions. In order to practice all the initiation perfectly, in order to get the result after you receiving initiation, you must practice three of them. You must. There's no exception. So from the very start, adopt is here by the practice. This for your motive. I shall gain Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings. So from the beginning point, from the starting point, you must need this kind of motivation. I shall gain Buddhahood. Buddhahood for what? For sake of all sentient beings. I mentioned yesterday, Buddhahood is not your goal. Your goal is, helping all sentient beings. It's your goal. Buddhahood is like a container. In order to, satisfy the thirsty, you need to drink water. In order to drink water, you need a container. So Buddhahood, the Buddha state is like a container. Benefiting sentient being is not like drinking water. I shall practice after taking this practical teaching on the three different scope of the Lamrim. Bring all your motive and action in the land with a subtle thought and only then listen. So before you listen to Lamrim, you must develop the right motivation. If you have a right motivation, the motivation towards the Buddhahood, sake of all sentient being, that means your action is bringing in the right line. And what is the dharma you are going to hear? It is the dharma of the superior vehicle of Mahayana teaching. the stream, you know, the system that leads the fortunate to level of Buddhahood. It is a tradition part of the, you know, two great champion, Nagarjuna and Asanga. You know, so this is the tradition of Nagarjuna, Asanga. So you must develop the bodhicitta in order to lessen the Lamrim, in order to practice Lamrim, in order to practice any kind of Mayan teaching, you must develop the bodhicitta. So look at, when you think about the meaning, you know, they're just very simple words. Bodhi, citta. Bodhi is talking about Buddhahood. Bodhi. Citta is mind. Okay? Mind towards Buddhahood. Bodhi, citta. Then the person who have a bodhi citta, then we call Bodhisattva. Bodhi citta. Also, bodhi has another meaning, essence. Essence. Bodhi has the essence. Also, bodhi is kind of, you know, the Buddhahood. And the long sentence, because we can, you know, it depended because of Changchuk, Bodhi. Changchuk, like Bodhi, you know, Buddha. Then Changchuk is same is mind. You know, mind towards Buddhahood. You know, in order to benefit all sentient beings. Bodhi. And so if you have some knowledge about mind and mental factor, the bodhicitta is included into the mental factor. Sorry, mind, not mental factor. We have a few very new. Within our motivation, we have a bad motivation, we have a good motivation, we have a neutral. We have so many different types of, you know, emotions, consciousness. But all of them include into two, mind or mental factors. Attachment, desire, anger, compassion, all of them is mental factor. And the bodhicitta is mind. You know, also we have a eyes consciousness. Within the eyes consciousness, we have a, you know, the eyes, we can call eyes mind and eyes mental factor. Within the eyes consciousness, we have a two, okay? And also we have a five senses. Within the five senses, you know, there's someone included into mental factor, someone included into mind. Generally, people, you know, don't understand differences between mind and mental factor. So if you're interested to know, then you can read, you know, particular book which is mentioned about mind and mental factor. In Tibetan, we call lori, mind. So bodhicitta is the mind. Great compassion, or love, kindness, tolerance, faith are mental factor, not a mind. Mind and mental factor are true contradictory phenomena. Okay, it's not just one, it's totally different mind. So mind still. Buddha, you know, bodhicitta. So this is the tradition of, you know, two champions, because, you know, Nagarjuna and Asanga is the sense of the thought of peerless Adisha and the great Tsongkapa, the Dharma king of the three realms. You know, with Tsongkapa name, you call Tsongkapa, you can get Dharma king of the three realms. So the motivation, you know, the Buddha, the bodhicitta is the peerless thought. This is how the instruction is performed. You know, it contains every single key point of the essence of the 84,000, you know, bundles of scripture. So why, you know, the Lamrim is, you know, very important, very profound teaching, because it contains, you know, all point of the essence of the 84,000 bundles of scripture. So according to Mahayana tradition, we always mention, you know, Buddha taught you know, 84,000 bundles of teaching. Why he taught 84,000 bundles of teaching? Because individually, each sentient being has, you know, 84,000 different types of, you know, negative emotions, or positive negative emotions, and organized in the, you know, proper sequence, the practice leading to individual being, you know, beings enlightenment. So when you look at the Heart Sutra, when you, you know, recite the Heart Sutra, is in the Heart Sutra, it mentions all the practice, you know, bodhicitta, Four Noble Truth, 12 Links Interdependent, Great Compassion, you know, three jewels. When you look at the teaching, you cannot see the sequencing, you cannot see the order, right? That's why in Asanga, he was studying about the, you know, profound teaching. For example, you know, the Prajaparamita teaching. He was studying, you know, this teaching. He got a lot of confusion. He didn't know where I must start practice, where I must end. And secondly, he has a lot of confusion because in the profound teaching, he mentioned, you know, the trailing interdependent, for example, trailing interdependent again. He thought, it's not really make sense for me. Then finally, he thought, you know, I must, you know, practice Mitriya Buddha, because he knows Mitriya Buddha, you know, can teach him everything very detailedly. Then he was doing, you know, a lot of practice in order to meet Mitriya Buddha in India, Mitriya Buddha. So he was in the care for many years, doing a lot of practice in order to meet, in order to have a vision of Mitriya Buddha. Then finally he thought, oh, I don't think I'm going to meet Mitriya Buddha. He gave up. He just came out of this cab, and he saw a very old man, you know, holding a thick metal, right, with a polishing with the soap coated. He was cleaning the, you know, thick metal, polishing by the soap coated. The Asanga asked, what are you doing? The old man said, I'm going to make a needle. Needle with a, you know, soap cushion. He thought, oh, I have not enough, you know, I didn't put enough effort. He entered again the cab. And he was disguised, he came out again. He was looking around, he saw in the morning one bird, you know, crossing a mountain. Each time he crossed the mountain, he touched his wing touched to the mountain, the tip of the mountain. He came back, he touched, and the rock became very smooth. Just tap one time with the feather, with the wind. Then he thought, oh, I'm not enough, you know, put enough effort. And he returned to the cab, and he still, and he continued, he did, you know, a lot of practice. Finally, then he met Mitriya Buddha. He saw Mitriya Buddha in his cab, and he was not so happy. He put, you know, a lot of effort. He was not a long time in the cab. He said, oh, you are not enough compassion. Because I spent all this time in the cab, it takes a long time to see you. Then Mitriya Buddha said, I'm not, very not compassion. I have enough compassion, but you have a very thick, you know, negative karma. Very strong negative karma, because you're not healing the negative karma. Oh, no, not that. Then, that's finally, you know, he totally gave up. So he just walked out the cab, and he saw a dog, you know, because a dog had a little wound. So he got very strong compassion to the dog. He wanted to save the dog life. In order to save the dog life, we have to clean the womb, right? Mm. Or the big womb. If we take womb from the dog, you know the womb will die. And then he could come, what I should do? Then he cut it himself. He's a
you know, piece of meat from his leg. His leg? Lamb. He cut a piece of meat and put all the jam. But he cannot touch because the jam, you know, the wound was so fragile. Can say, you know, and he tried to, you know, bring, take out the his mouth. He was tired of touching the womb by lip, you know. He cannot touch the dog body. Then he thought, what happened? He opened the eyes, he saw Mitriya Buddha. Look at, finally, then he said, oh, I don't think you are enough compassion. It's taken a long time to see you. He said, it's not my fault because you have a strong, you know, sin or strong negative karma. Because you develop genuine compassion towards the dog, mm-hmm. It eliminates all the negative karma. That's why you're able to see me. Mm-hmm. But I think it is a joke. Okay, next one. Then he said, if you don't believe me, you look at me, my clothes. Because while, you know, Asanga doing meditation, he's split, right? Split? And he split his clothes on the Indian clothes. Look at, yeah. I've always been you. But you know, still Asanga didn't believe. He said, okay, if you don't believe me, just, you know, carry me on your shoulder, walk around the village. Asanga carry Mitriya Buddha on his shoulder, walk around the village. Somebody said, look at Asanga carry a dog. Somebody didn't say anything. Then he said, look at, but some people who saw me as a dog, they are quite, you know, good person who has a very little negative karma. The people don't see me on your shoulder, they have a lot of negative karma. So that's why your karma, you know, interrupt or block me to see, meet each other. Now finally, so Asanga met Mitriya Buddha, and Mitriya Buddha explained all the meaning of, you know, the profound teaching. That's why Asanga received the, you know, the extensive lineage of Mitriya Buddha. So sometimes we have a complaint, right? Oh, I have been practicing Dharma for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, almost all my life, but I didn't meet any Buddha. I didn't see any Buddha. You know. But we never think ourselves how much, you know, the negative karma I have. So this is, you know, kind of, you know, interesting story. Then, you know, Asanga went to the Tushita land and he spent there. Somebody said he spent there only he spent only morning, one morning in the Tushita land, and he came back and he received, you know, the five teachings which is taught by Mitriya Buddha, and he finally understood the meaning of, you know, profound teaching, Prajaparamita teaching, because all the meanings, you know, hit in there. So, you know, Asanga, also we can call Tsongkapa, or you can call, you know, king of the three realms. This is how the instruction is performed. It is contained, you know, all the, you know, the teaching, all the part, sequencing. That's why sequencing is, you know, sequencing. So that's why when you look at Hasutra, you cannot see, you know, the accumulation part, preparation part, seeing part, renunciation. You cannot see. Sometimes you can see, but you cannot put into sequencing. So it's same, you know, the Prajaparamita teaching, Buddha talk many times, again and again, again and again. You don't understand the sequence of, you know, extensive teaching, extensive meaning. The, you know, the practical discourse on the stage of the path to enlightenment can be brought under the one basic heading. So do you understand the meaning of heading? Heading. So with Tibetan we call subject, okay, heading. I don't know the English does mean heading. It looks like not like context, it's not like map. You know, if I really want to know about the Singapore, I have to know the four directions, east, west, and south, right? East and south, or this is east coast, this is south. this kind of heading is kind of the map. So in order to practice Lamrim, you need to know the heading, you need to know the map, you know, which one I first practice, which one I really have to second practice, which one I have to practice in the third. There's an order, there's a sequence, like a heading. The actual teaching, you know, but more heading have been introduced in order to fix the nature of the Lamrim. Is what is list. There's, you know, different teaching, you know, different Lamrim have a different heading. And the sequence of the teaching, you must familiarize yourself with the heading. So the heading, right? You must familiar with the kind of man, you must familiar with the context. Heading so as to be sure which of them come under the particular topic of meditation, how they are, you know, explained, the question cited, oh yeah, so question and cited in them. The lineage of the oral teaching and the, you know, instruction, the content, right? Sorry, instruction, the content, right? The content. So anyway, the leading is so important, you know. So which meditation center I must practice this and that. So next we're going to explain you the, you know, the heading. Otherwise, if you receive and of the cup teaching mixed together randomly without any heading. So that's why, you know, if you don't understand the heading, then you cannot practice orderly. You got, you know, somebody you practice this, somebody that. So the heading, you know, the rule, the map is so important to put everything everything in orderly. The heading is very important. Randomly, without any heading, it would be hard to make the meditation beneficial for your mindstand. It would be like trying to use tea, you know, butter, salt, and soda. So if you don't have you don't put in order, then you cannot have the right practice. For example, you really want to make a tea, you got a, you know, butter, you got a salt, he's talking about Tibetan tea. You know, butter, salt, and soda, all mixed together instead of from separate jar, you know. So you must put the salt, butter, and the soda separately. If you put together, you cannot make a good tea. So that's why, for example, you can understand the renunciation, emptiness, great compassion, you know, for so. If you don't have a order, if you don't have an idea how I can put in the order, then you cannot practice. So it's so important that, you know, that the heading. So the butters is called mixed together. Through there are many different set of heading. Some of the headings in Lamrim and some of the longer version, you know. Some has a very short kind of brief heading, some has a long or version. You should follow the heading of the particular teaching you have received. Because now we are going to study about Lamrim, you must follow, you know, the heading of Lamrim. So now we got two traditions. Now my teacher own, you know, particular methods consists of series of topic that are based preliminary on the soft part. It's sweet part is another Lamrim name. And the Odrian, which many oral instruction. So we have a two Lamrim, you know, there's so many, so his teacher, he give teaching, you know, sweet part and the odren part. The odren is kind of, I think, very hard English words, but in direct is like the pleasant, you know, enjoyable kind of. One is, you know, we call it the sweet part, you know, very easy to achieve kind of liberation, sweet or quick part, right? Sweet or quick. Another is kind of, you know, denam is, you know, the very pleasant way with many oral instruction. It had never before been written down, but I was most careful when he gave them in public, and I also received them in private. I have taken great care to the collect them and comment them to paper, you know, so there's a two kinds of Lamrim, the sweet part and the, you know, ordinary Lamrim. So he received the teaching from his guru, you know, finally he put, you know, written into paper. They are neither too short nor too long, and the manner of the producing meditative experience is exceptional and has unique point. This is how I shall, you know, press to the assembly. So he going to give the term teaching based on the two Lamrim, the sweet part and the adren Lamrim. So assembly, then he was saying what kind of teaching I'm going to give, you know. The scholar of Sri Nalanda monastery used to say that it was important to teach their, you know, purity before giving a teaching. It's called Nalanda tradition. We have got two traditions. One is the Nalanda tradition, one is the Bikamala Shila tradition. According to Nalanda tradition, the purity is very important to give the teaching. Before giving a teaching, the purity of the master, you know, master oral teaching, the purity of mind stream of the disciple, and the purity of dharma being presented. So, according to Nalanda tradition, before you receive a teaching, you know, you must purify three things. You must purify the master oral teaching, you must purify your mental mind stream, you must purify the teaching. Then you know, master oral, like purify master oral. For example, before you receive the teaching from your master, you must know what kind of teaching he going to give, where he received the teaching. For example, now I'm being, you know, explaining you that this Lamrim teaching, this how of the Lamrim teaching I received from His Holiness Dalai Lama, Lhasa in South India. So I'm going to receive whole teaching this year. So him received from, you know, Tijan Rinpoche received Pabongka. Pabongka Rinpoche teaching his master Padisha, so all the way from Buddha. So, you know, purify, you know, teacher oral transmission. Then second, yes, the teaching is coming all the way from Buddha to my guru, my master. Now, right, teaching is taught by Buddha. Now, next what? Okay, I'm going to receive the teaching. You need to check your motivation. Purify your mind stream. You need to check your motivation. What kind of motivation you have? Then you need to develop the genuine motivation, which is the bodhicitta. Now you finish, you know, your teaching is coming from Buddha all the way to my guru. I have a good motivation. Next, you know, purify the dharma. So next, the third one is, you know, the first one, you know, purify the teacher oral transmission. And also you need to check, yes, the master or the guru, the lama going to teach me dharma. What kind of motivation he or she has? You know, sometimes you can see when you meet a certain Rinpoche from Tibet, Tibetan Rinpoche, or Tibetan Geshe, Tibetan Lama, you must, they will say, oh, are you interested in Buddhism? Oh yes, I have very special teaching, you must come, I teach you. That moment you need to check the motivation, you know. And also sometimes you can say, yes, I have got very profound teaching, which is not mentioned in Buddha teaching. You know, it's not taught by Buddha Shakyamuni. I received the Buddha teaching from, you know, direct from someone. Or I have the teaching because I got a lot of vision. The thought is very fantastic, you know. That's why you have, you must clarify the master oral transmission. So for you, it's so important, you know. Do we have a time? Okay, here. Yeah. For you, one is I really want to tell you, because most of you, you know, always interested in studying Buddhism, practice Buddhism, always you are looking kind of, you know, you are very kind of enthusiasm to looking at Dharma. Then, for you really need to check, because when you saw, they put some poster, okay, some Rinpoche is coming, giving any session, you know, some Geshe is coming, giving the teaching, you must get, you know, the information about the Rinpoche, about the master, whatever. You need to get the right information. Is he a scholar? Is he a practitioner? Is he quite, you know, popular in Tibetan society? Some of the Rinpoche, we never heard their name, history in Tibetan society. They are quite popular in Singapore, Malaysia, Hong Kong, China, everywhere. They don't have any kind of name in the Tibetan monastery, in Tibetan society. That means this kind of Rinpoche or, you know, master, not that's, you know, the popular, not scholar. Then, before you attend the teaching, you must think, okay, yes, the Rinpoche or the Geshe or, you know, the Shifu from China, whatever, they're really scholar, master, good, but this teaching is important for me or not? You know, I must attend the teaching or not? Yes, he going to give this teaching. I don't think this teaching is, you know, relevant for me, useful for me. Yes, teaching is good, but I don't think I can practice. It's better, you know, don't attend the teaching. Because if you, if the teaching is not that useful for you, then why you are attending the teaching? Because you think, you know, yes, right master, right teaching, but you should think it's useful to me or not. If it's not useful, then, you know, better not attend the teaching. If you attend the teaching, while you in the teaching, listen very carefully, try to understand as much as you can, then the very important one, try to practice as much as you can. Okay, so it's really important for you to check the master, check the master oral transmission, and check the teaching. So, you know, according to Narada tradition, three purify, you know, purify of the master oral teaching, purify of the, you know, disabled mental stream, and purify the teaching. So when you, you know, attend the teaching, you must need a good motivation. If you don't have a good motivation, if you have a just bad motivation, that means you look like, you know, a pot with a lot of lot of dirty thing. Somebody put in water, the water become very melly, right? Water with dirty, you cannot drink. Motivation. So you have a good motivation. If you don't listen carefully, then you don't understand the teaching correctly, then also useless. Or you have a good motivation, or you listen the teaching very carefully, you know, with a good motivation. If you have some other, you know, other motivation, also useless. So, you know, purify the teacher, oral teaching, purify the, disabled mental stream, and purify the Dharma. This is a tradition of Nalanda, Nalanda tradition. The next one, you know, the scholar of Vikramarashila. In their, you know, introduction, used to discuss the, you know, greatness of the author. greatness of the Dharma. Then I think there's only two or three. Yeah, there are three, right? Greatness of the author, greatness of the Dharma, and the way to explain and the lesson to the teaching. So the, you know, so when you receive a teaching, you must understand who wrote, who composed the teaching. You must know about the author. Don't know, you know, sometimes you can see. In the modern time, some Westerner, they came, you know, India, spent few years, and they receive, you know, attend some class, and they are really good in English. They just compose books. They author some books, they wrote some books and publish in the Europe and America. And this kind of teaching, you know, they just compose, they just wrote without experience. And sometimes you can see there are a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of interpretation. That's why, if you really want to read a book about Dharma in English, in Chinese, first you must know who wrote the book, how long he or she studied for Buddhism, how long, and is or she is called a practitioner or not. Just reading book is very easy, you know. Through experience is not easy. The second, you know, the greatness of the teaching. The next one, you know, the way to explain and the lesson to the teaching. I shall follow the latter one. So we, in the next, we are going to explain three things, you know, the greatness of the author, the greatness of the teaching, the way to explain and the lesson to the teaching. So now we need to talk about, you know, a lesson of teaching. I think it is very popular in, I'm not sure in Chinese tradition, when we build a monastery or temple, we always put wheel of Dharma. Two sides, there's two deer, right? So wheel of Dharma is symbol of Buddha teaching. So wheel of Dharma has the eighth spot.
Yes.
You know, this symbol of the at you know, unfold Arya path. The wheel has a ring, a symbol of, you know, mindfulness. In the middle of the eight spots, there's a main point, right? We can attach the eight spot, right? This is the symbol of Shila. Symbol of Shila. Shila, the eight spot is symbol of, you know, wisdom. The ring is symbol of mindfulness, right? Then beside the two, beside the Dharma, there's always two deers.
Mm-hmm.
When you go next time, when you visit Nalanda, Ajanta Ellora cave, very famous cave, it's used to be Buddhist monastery. And this time we put the Dharma wheel like this side, right? Face like this way. And in the Ajanta cave, they put the wheel like this set. We're facing like this, it's facing like this wheel. Not this way, in a two different way. Then there are always two deers, you know, male and female. This the two deer symbol of, you know, disciple of Buddha Dharma, disciple of Buddha Shakyamuni, all of symbol of, you know, the follow of Buddha Dharma, male and female. According to Buddhism, according to Buddha Dharma, there's not any differentiate between male and female. Everybody has a right to receive Buddha teaching. Everybody has a right to practice Buddha teaching, no differences, male and female. But both deer is always, you know, looking to the wheel, do like that, neck very long, and just looking like this. That means when you listen a teaching, when you attend a teaching, when you practice Dharma, shouldn't be kind of, you know, laziness, sleepy, very, with a fresh mind, and you have to watch like this. And also the deer itself. Look at, now we have a zoo. We keep, you know, the deer in the zoo. They have a shelter. Generally, the deer doesn't have a shelter. And they have a grass here, eat today, sleep here, next move there, eat grass, move there. They don't have permanent kind of shelter, permanent place. So this means symbol of, you know, shouldn't have an attachment with your livelihood. Where you live, what you eat, what you have, you shouldn't have an attachment. You look like deer. You always be look like deer. That's why this is a very important symbol of wheel of Dharma, true deers, you know. That's why, you know, so, you know, how to explain, how to listen. What time is it now?
45.
We have 45, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. 15 minutes. 15
minutes.
Oh, 15 minutes. Now it's 45. Okay. Now, you know, the way to explain and the lesson to the teaching, I shall follow this, the later tradition, the, you know, Bikarmala Shila. The, you know, the Bikarmala Shila, the Nalanda University, the Takshashila, three are the most of the ancient university in the world. Second, that they built university in the Athens, right? Athens in Greek.
Athens.
Second, they built university in Athens. First, they built university in the world, okay, in India. Nalanda, Bikarmala Shila, and Takshila. Takshila is now very close, at the 40 kilometers away from Nalanda. Bikarmala Shila. Takshashila is, I think, Takshashila is now right now in Pakistan. In this moment in Pakistan, Takshashila. The discourse on the stage of the path to enlightenment has four major paths. The guidance of the author, given in order to show the teaching, has an, you know, immaculate source. The second, the greatness of the Dharma, give to the increase one faith in the instruction. Third is the right way to teach and listen to this Dharma with the true greatness. Now it is very important, you know, the headlines. So why we have to know the greatness of the, you know, author? That means, you know, the study has been important part. The greatness of the author, giving the oral it to show that the teaching has an immaculate source. That means where the teaching is come from, right? Where the teaching is come from. The second is what? The greatness of the Dharma is given to increase one's faith in the instruction. So when you study about the Dharma, then you can increase faith in the instruction. So when you understand, you know, for example, somebody bought new laptop here. We don't have any idea about the laptop or mobile or any new technology. And then, you know, this is a new technology. We thought, oh, nice. If somebody explain very detailedly, it's very, you know, handy, it's very useful, it's things, they explain very good quality, then we feel, I must buy. Same, you know, when you study about Dharma, where the Dharma come from, what he explained, what is the beneficial, and finally you feel, oh, I must practice, I must receive teaching, I must practice, and increase the faith in instruction after you study of Dharma. The next one, the right way to teach and the lesson to the Dharma.
So, you know, how the master must explain, how the disciple must listen. You know, where to teach and listen to this Dharma with their true grandness. The sequence in which disciples are to be taught the actual instruction. Then, you know, so, you know, giving teaching is not just, you know, giving a speech in generally, you know, giving a lecture, but I'm not really in master, you know, how to give a teaching. Am I really master, you know, giving teaching? First, I really want to know what kind of teaching I must give you, you know, how long, how short, you know, so I really have to know how to teach. Otherwise, you know, lecture is doesn't care, you know, they have to say something, just they say in publicly, it benefit or they are not, they don't care. So, because after giving teaching, the main point is, you know, I really want to lead the disciple, the student towards Nirvana. You know, that's why I have to give the teaching very carefully, you know, very precisely, no confusion, discourage. So, you know, this way, how to teach, how to listen is so important. Finally, you know, they lead to the Nirvana or omission. The fourth, you know, for the sequence in which is disciples are to be taught the actual instruction, the four hidden are found in the Tsongkhapa, great cities of the path. No matter which Lamrim is being presented, you know, the easy path, in the sweet path, and so forth. So doesn't matter which Lamrim, they always have a four. The greatest author, greatest of the teaching, how to teach and how to listen, and how to lead the disciple towards, you know, the Nirvana omission. No matter how much detail it is being given in, the oral tradition says you must start with the heading, must start this heading. Otherwise, people will not develop the enough conviction, right? So, it looks like, you know, so someone have a very strong desire to achieve Buddhahood. Now, the people or the person looking, you know, methods, how I can achieve omniscience. Then they say, okay, if you really wish to achieve Buddhahood, you must practice this teaching. In order to have a strong desire, then I have to explain, okay, this teaching, this Lamrim or this text, written by Adisha, then I have to explain the quality of the Adisha. Then I have to explain the quality of the teaching. Then the person thinks, yes, I must study because the author was good, you know, the teaching is good, then it's very relevant for you, then you can have a strong desire to practice Lamrim. That's why, you know, finally you have really, you know, strong conviction to study about Lamrim or, you know, this thing. So it's so important we got, you know, four headlands. So just keep them on, so then we have to go, you know, one by one. But next, I think there's talking a lot of talking about the biography of Adisha. Very easy to just, you know, read. But for me, not easy to read. Yeah. Okay, I think we just stop here. So we do as usual, do meditation. And now we need to put everything in order, okay? Okay, first day what we talk about. The first day what we talk about. We talk about the falsity, you know, the falsity of Lord Ram, and also suffering in Lord Ram. The suffering in the, you know, higher realm, we're talking about a lot of, you know, suffering everywhere. Just like talking about, you know, first we talk about, you know, the valuable, human love is valuable. So easy to achieve, so easy to, so difficult to achieve, so easy to lose. that you need to consider your my life is so important, not easy to have this kind of life. Then see, okay, after I death, where shall I go? There's only true migration, right? True immigration or migration?
Migration.
True migration. Lower and our upper. Then you need to check. Okay, I just forget about previous life. Within this life, how much, you know, the positive karma I accumulate? How much negative karma I accumulated? Then you think, yes, I accumulate both. Positive, negative. You compare with them. Then you think, yes, I did same. Then you need to think, okay, in order to accumulate good karma, you know, the motivation, actual action, and the end action, right? So in order to accumulate good action, you need to have good motivation. Sometimes we have a good motivation, no good actual action. Sometimes we have a good actual action, but we don't have a, you know, good motivation, we don't have a good end motivation. You compare yourself, the positive karma, negative karma, then you can feel, yes, I have a lot of negative karma which I accumulated on this life, just forget in the previous life. So due to have a lot of negative karma, I'm almost after, you know, a death, I will reborn in the lower realm. Then you need thinking, oh, I don't want to reborn there. I must escape. In order to escape then, I must understand the law of causality of the lower realm, law of causality of our realm. You know, then you really need to avoid the negative karma, accumulate good karma. Maybe then we're talking about renunciation. Then you need to think, okay, I must escape samsara, but I must escape, you know, myself, I must consider all sentient being. Then you think, yes, I was, you know, born 100 or 1,000 times, reborn everywhere. Yes, but all sentient being used to be my mom, my dear one. They are so kind to me. I shouldn't avoid them. I must consider them, you know, develop sense of compassion, you know. Then we think, well, you know, I must give a lot of benefit to all sentient beings. In order to give a lot of benefit, I must practice Dharma, you know, achieve omniscience. In order to achieve omniscience, practice Dharma. In order to practice Dharma, I must need to find the right Dharma. Okay, it's Lamrim. Then, after you think, you know, after practice Lamrim, which kind of teaching I must practice? Yes? The author must be, you know, experienced one, scholar, and the teaching must be, you know, good quality. So you just put everything in order. Okay, now you are rich, you know, almost, you know, I must practice Lamrim in order to benefit all sentient beings. So just put together. Okay? Just reflect what we talked, you know, in the past, and just meditate on whatever you want.